They say sometimes you win some, sometimes you lose some. And right now I'm losing back. I've stood on this stage night after night, reminding the broken it would be alright. But right now, oh right now, I just can't. It's easy to sing when there's nothing to bring me down. Oh, what will I say when I'm held to the flame like I am right now? I know you're able and I know you can sift through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my hope is you alone. They say it only takes a little faith to move a mountain. When you choose to lift mountains unmovable, oh, give me the strength to be able to sing. It is well with my soul. I know you're able and I know you can sift through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you know, my hope is you alone. I know the sorrow and I know the hurt. It'll all go away if you just say the word. But even if you don't, my hope is you alone.
You've been faithful, you've been
thank you.
out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Darkness shine out of the eyes. light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is
I worship you.
come up and pray for us?
Let's pray. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity and the blessing to be in your temple once again. Lord, I thank you for this and many things. Lord, we ask for your presence here this morning, Lord God. Lord, we ask, Lord, that you will mend hearts this morning. Lord, I pray for the mom who's crying for the children. Lord, I pray for the grandfather who's crying for the grandchildren. Lord, you know where our heart is this morning. And as the book of Psalms said, Lord, that your ears are open to our cry. Lord, we are crying to you this morning, Lord God, for our brothers and sisters in Europe. Father, we have no control. We don't know what's going on there, Lord God, but you know the hearts of all these leaders in Europe. You know the heart of Putin, Lord, and you know what he's up to. But Lord, we believe that you can take care of that. We believe that you can change his heart. We believe that you can change his mind, Lord God. You can turn everything for good. For you are a good God. Lord, we pray here at home, Lord, that you will bless Pastor Ramiro and his wife. Give them that time of refresh, Lord. Give them that time, Lord, that they need. Lord, help them. It's a big responsibility, Lord, they're taking, but Lord, I pray that you will guide him, watch over him, but mostly, Lord, keep him healthy for years to come. Lord, we're still praying for Orlando, Lord. You know we miss him, but we know that you're using him where he is. He is where you want him to be. And I pray, Lord, that he will be worshiping you. He will be serving you wherever he is, Lord. Guide him, protect him, watch over him, and bring him back soon. Lord, I thank you for Pastor Victor here, Lord God, that you will anoint him, that you will speak your word through him. Bring your word forth, Lord God. We're here to hear from you this morning. Lord, we bow down before your throne of grace this morning to say thank you. Thank you for another day. Thank you, Lord. Even though things are going on around us, Lord, but you're still faithful. You're still the God that you promised to be. You're still the God that loves us. Your grace is upon us. Your compassion is all over us. So I pray, Lord, that we just open the eyes of our heart to see you, Lord God. Thank you for this youth group, Lord God. Thank you for who they are and who are they becoming to be. Your servants. They are your children, Lord God. And I thank you for all the people behind it. For all the people that's praying for them. Give them the strength, Lord God, to continue this ministry. For it is you who have made all this possible. Bless your church. Bless this day, Lord God. Give us a wonderful time together in your presence. You are invited and you're welcome in this temple. We love you, thank you, give you all the glory and all this honor for who you are. In the name of our beloved Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
I'll never know how much it costs.
Hello? Yeah, my voice is kind of gone, so like. So yeah, this song is a very special song to me. I was singing it during quarantine, and it's just amazing, so yeah. God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time. With no point of reference, you spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of light. And as you speak, 100 billion galaxies are born in the vapor of your breath. The planets form. If the stars were made to worship, so will I. I can see your heart in everything you've made. Every burning star is signal fire of grace. If creation should sing your praises, so will I. So will I. God of your promise, you don't speak in vain, no silable, empty or void. For once you have spoken, all nature and science follow the sound of your voice. Catch your breath, evolving in pursuit of what you say. If it all reveals in nature, so will I. I can see your heart in everything you say. Every painted sky, a canvas of your grace. If creation also obeys you, so will I. So will I. Worship, so will I. If the mountains bow in reverence, so will I. If the oceans roar your praises, so will I. For if everything exists to lift you high, so will I. Then we'll see. light of the world, abandoned in darkness to die. And as you speak, 100 billion failures disappear. Where you lost your life so I can find it here. If you left the grave behind you, so will I.
Morning. I'm here on behalf of Emmett Gordon, our men's president, to announce the first of the year's men's ministry meeting. It will be April 9th at 9 a.m. in the communication building. The mandates have been relaxed, so we'll be getting together inside, but I hope we do go back outside. We used to meet at Bowman Park last year, and that was great. I hope we get to do that again. The theme of this year is going to be ministry to our brothers and others. It's going to be a little more outreach this year, I think, with the men's ministries, visiting shut-ins, doing some more things that we should be doing. But we need to be rooted up together. Like the newsletter says this month, we need to be rooted, and we need to be a team for the Lord. So 9 a.m., April 9th in the communications building. Thank you.
Good morning, church. Did you all enjoy the youth up here singing and playing music? They all started at Friday Bible School. And we are going to start Friday Bible School again at the end of April. More information will come out about that. If you are interested in helping, you do not have to commit to every single Friday. But if you are interested in helping, please find me, talk to me, let me know. Thank you.
You know, speaking of the youth, not too long ago, they were all up there congregating. Then I finally got them to go in there. You know, I guess I was kind of rushing them, like I always do. But you know, when I went in there, I thought they were going to be, oh, Mr. Vick, you're always rushing, blah, 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 blah. But instead, you know what they did? They fixed my tie. They fixed my tie clip. And one of them, they even fixed my jacket. Now, how do you like that for youth, huh? But Jaron did fix this up here a little tight around the neck, though, but I don't think he did that on purpose. No. Pastor is on vacation, or not vacation, he's on the retreat, or some kind of refresher thing there, you know, under Pastor Steve Margeson and his wife that's spearheading this. No, I pray they're going to have a blessed time. Pastor was excited to go. I guess he's been there before. He couldn't wait to go. No, I told him, make sure you call me before you leave. He didn't go. He didn't call me. He was gone. That was it. He didn't want to hear anything from me. No, but I'm so happy for him that he gets to go away, him and his wife, you know, without the children. No, they love them, but sometimes, you know, they need that quality time for themselves. Amen? Amen, church? Okay. Now, today, you know, I'm going to talk about the Church of Laodicea. This is in the book of Revelations. First, I want to say that over the years, I have noticed that people leave this church, you know, in order to go to another church. But I don't know any of the reasons why they go. They just go. Sometimes they would go to a new church, and after a while, they would leave that church too. I guess it's their right to go to the church of their choice. But I like to call them professional churchgoers, because they bounce from church to church in search of the perfect church. And we all know there's no such thing as a perfect church. And as I've heard it said before many times, and you have too, if there was a perfect church and you went to it, the church would no longer be perfect. That's right. I hate to see people leave this church. You know, people that I care about leave this church because I've grown fond of them. I've grown close to them. But hey, sometimes people move. Sometimes people move to another community or another state. You know, but sometimes people leave in order to start their own church. Amen? But we as a church should remain as a church. And I pray that we always will stick together. And let's face it, people we care about have left this church, and who knows, there may be a few more. But on the other hand, we may receive new members because God is on the move. And you know what? He expects us to be on the move. He expects us to be on the move. He expects this church to be on the move. In the day where many churches are folding or closing for one reason or another, we have a church right here that is still going strong despite the storms that this church has faced. And we have faced some storms. Today I'm going to talk about a church that was in a storm, but they didn't know they was in a storm. God has something to say to all of us now about that church and about the church that we better not become. So now I invite you to stand for the reading of God's holy word. We're going to go to the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 3, verse 14 to 22. I remember back in the day, I used to be scared about the book of Revelation. Reverend Bill Graham be preaching on TV about Revelation, and I'd be shaking, boy. You know, sometimes Pastor Shaver would preach about Revelation, and as a youth, I was shaking too. But now, since I'm mature in Christ, even though need to get maturer, Revelation is not that scary to me, but in a way it is, because I see other people that are my family, friends, and people in God's church that are not ready. You know, sometimes I ask the Lord for a vision of my friends and family going to hell so that way I can get up off my behind and start bringing people into church and start letting people know that Jesus Christ is alive and well and that he cares for them. Amen? Okay, Revelation 3, verse 14 to 22. The word of the Lord says to the angel of the church in Laodicea, write, these are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So, because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. You say, I am rich, I have acquired wealth, and do not need a thing. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, so you may become rich, and white clothes to wear, so you can cover your shameful nakedness, and salve to put on your eyes, so you can see. Those whom I have loved, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I was victorious and sat down with my Father on his throne. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Father, we thank thee for these words. Father, Lord, I pray, Lord, today that these words would resonate in our hearts, Father, Lord, not just our minds, Father. I pray, Lord, even though after the service, Lord, these things may we ponder, Father, Lord. I pray, Lord, for the transformation of this church and the churches all across America and the churches across the world, Father, Lord. May we be a church that serves Jesus courageously, Lord. We thank you for this time together, Lord. And I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, let me ask you something. Can you imagine being in a church that makes Jesus sick? Can you imagine being a part of a church that makes Jesus sick? Just thinking that a church makes Jesus sick is sickening. This is the position of the Laodicean church. This is the position that they found themselves in. What was going on in this church was not pleasing to God at all. This church was in trouble, and like I said, they didn't even know it. Jesus' letter to the church of Laodicea is the harshest of the seven churches that was in the Asia Minor. But why was this so? Because you know why? It looked like Laodicea, it looked like they had it going on. Because Laodicea was located 40 miles southeast of the Church of Philadelphia. They had a banking center and as well as a medical facility that was famous for what they call eye-salve. Now, eye-salve was a powder, a local powder that was made from stone, the local stone, and it was used to treat dry eyes and eye infections. And they were also known for their famous black wool. Now, the water sources in Laodicea came via aqueduct from both hot springs and cold mountain waters. And by the time they reached Laodicea, it was neither hot nor cold. And what's crazy about this is that all the wealth that this city had poor water. The water was good for nothing. It was nauseating. And that was the Lord's response to the Laodiceans. They sickened him. See, Jesus Christ begins this message by identifying himself as the one that's given this message. He describes himself in verse 14 as the Amen, the faithful and the true witness, and the ruler of God's creation. Now, after he identifies himself, Jesus wastes no time in telling the church of Laodicea that he knows their works, that they are neither cold nor hot, and because they are lukewarm, that he's going to spit them out of his mouth. This is what he tells them, folks. Now, this gets their attention. Jesus then explains why he described their spiritual condition as lukewarm. You see, in verse 17, the Bible says, because you say, I am rich, have become wealthy, and have need of nothing, and do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. Christ's words shows them that he knew that the citizens of their city, he knew that they were wealthy. In fact, do you know how wealthy they were? They were so wealthy that they refused help from the government to rebuild their city after an earthquake tore it up. They built the city with their own funds. Now, can you imagine if there was an earthquake in New Bedford and the government said, we're going to pay for the rebuilding of the city. And we, the people, told the government, nah, that's all right. We got this. No, the Laodiceans told the government this twice, that we have this. And this was the Roman government that they were talking to. You know, it wasn't some rinky-dink government. You see, this wealth of the Laodiceans had blinded them, because wealth can do this. It blinded them from this seeing their true spiritual condition. Now, the culture of this city had infiltrated the church, and the members didn't know how spiritually wretched and weak they really were. Now, the culture of the city had infiltrated the church instead of the church infiltrating the city. And this is what's going on today. The church at Laodicea, it was a stale church, a church that lost its freshness, and they didn't even know it. There were many stale churches. There are many stale churches across America today that's losing its freshness. They've gotten away from the things that please God, and they too are about to be spit out. And here's what I mean about stale churches. I was reading a piece by Brian Powell, and this is what he said. The religious practice void of the Holy Spirit is more like a funeral service than a worship service. God is alive. Amen? God, everybody say, God is alive. That's right. I'm glad I'm impressed that you say it like you meant it. Jesus came and he said that we may have life. I've come that we may have life and have it more what? Abundantly. Yes, that's Bible school talking. This is how the church is supposed to exist, and that's how we're supposed to live. Amen? We're supposed to live an abundant life for Jesus Christ. Now, Powell goes on saying, living with the intentional awareness of the Holy Spirit must be the goal of anyone that's serious about following Jesus. Now, staleness sets in when we make our spiritual journey routine that we squeeze into our schedule alongside countless other items. Now, listen to me, God's people. Jesus doesn't want to be one of the things that's vying for your attention. He wants to be the only one with whom that we are captivated. Amen? Captivated. We know what that means. Captivated. A spell. An awe. All reverence to Almighty God. Now, what was the cause of this Laodicean staleness? At that time, Jesus had sent this message. And Laodicea was known all around the region for these three things, like I said before. They were known for their banking and trading center in the area. Yes, like I said, this was a really wealthy city. They were known for the fine black wool cloth that was produced there. And they were known for the eye ointment that was made there. So you see, they had it going on, like I said. So much so that the church became content. They became complacent. They were saying, we're rich. We don't need anything. We're happy where we're at. They didn't even need Jesus anymore. The church was happy with their own efforts, and they thought that they had it made because they had all this material things. The church had completely gotten away from Jesus, and they were depending on what they were doing. And so do you know what they did? They kicked Jesus out of their church without realizing it. But Jesus was now giving them a wake-up call. But today, Jesus is giving our church a wake-up call. He's giving me a wake-up call. He's giving you a wake-up call. He's telling the churches across America to wake up. Wake up, churches across America. He's giving us all a wake-up call. You know, there was a song back in the day that went, wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. Remember that song? No more time for backward thinking. It's time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred, war, and poverty, you know, and this song still is effective for today. We're to wake up and teach the truth. You see, Jesus is giving them a wake-up call, and he tells it as he sees it. He tells them that they are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. And you know, we go to a church on Sunday morning. We have good jobs, we might have a nice car, and maybe nice homes. We are materially prosperous, but spiritually miserable, wretched, poor, blind, and naked. And that's how we look to Jesus when we try to have church without him. This is what we look like when we do things that we want to do and ignore the things that Jesus Christ wants us to do. Laodicea, no, looked like the church of today. We're all wealthy. When you think about it, we're all wealthy compared to this entire world. Even the poorest new person in New Bedford is more so wealthy compared to a lot of people that's around this world. There are some of us, when you think about it, there are some of us who have shoes in boxes piled this high in their closet at home, but only can wear one at a time. You walk out of a $200,000 home or more, drive a real nice car, and go to a church that has a pretty good modern technology, and yet put a dollar in the offering plate. All because we are materially wealthy, but in Christ, we are what? Wretched, poor, pitiful, blind, and naked. Now, I heard one pastor quote another pastor and said, many are called and a few are chosen. But some people say it should read, many are cold and a few are frozen. Even though this church has issues, Jesus gives them a solution. He tells the Laodiceans to buy gold from him and to get their riches from him, to buy their clothes from him, clothes that will last. He tells them to buy ointment from him, ointment that truly heals blindness, eye ointment that truly heals blindness. Now, what is Jesus saying to the Laodiceans? What is Jesus telling us? What is Jesus telling the church of today? He's telling them, and he's telling us, that material things have no eternal value. Material things, there's no eternal benefits at all. You can't take it with you. Amen? You can't take it with you. I once heard Billy Graham say this, I have yet to see a U-Haul behind a hearse. So Jesus, this is what Jesus does. He commands them to come to him for true spiritual witness, for true spiritual riches. Isaiah chapter 55, within the first two verses, says this, come, all you who are thirsty, come to the waters, and you who have no money, come, buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without costs. Why spend money on what is not bread, and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen, listen to me, and eat what is good, and you will delight in the riches of fare. You see, only Christ can supply us with an everlasting inheritance, clothe us in righteousness, and he can heal our spiritual blindness. Everything produced on our own passes away. Everything. When are we going to realize this, church? Listen to this, and I'm not only speaking to our church, but I'm speaking to all churches. We can't accomplish kingdom things without the King running the show. Amen? We can't accomplish kingdom things without the King running the show. We can never be content where we're at. We can never be satisfied. We can never be sit there and be complacent. And may I say that if we're not letting Jesus be the source of everything that we do, then we fail as a church. We have to be totally dependent on him. Totally. Amen? Totally. You know good and well that we shouldn't sit back and say that we're finished, we're satisfied, we reached our quota, we reached our goal. There's always work to do in God's church. You know, if everyone in the world was saved except for one person, we still have work to do. Amen? May we never become complacent like the church at Laodicea. Jesus then notes his concern for the church at Laodicea. He says in verse 19, "Those whom I have loved, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent." The Bible says, repent. It doesn't say, slow down. His plan is for the church to repent. You're going in the wrong direction. Turn around, repent. Repent does not mean slow down. It doesn't mean I don't drink as much now. Repent doesn't mean I don't potty as much now. Repent doesn't mean I don't chase women that much now. That's not repentance. That's slowing down. Repentance means an immediate change of attitude and action from sin toward obedience to God. Amen? Immediate change. Not a gradual change, but an instant change of attitude. Amen? Instant change of attitude. Finally, Jesus says, "I stand at the door and knock," like Pastor likes to do. The church had the audacity to have Jesus standing on the outside of his own church. They were so content that they kicked Jesus out of the church. They didn't need him. Are we like that with our walk with Christ? You see, we have that nice, we may have that nice car. We may have that gorgeous woman on our arm or a man on our arm. We may have a nice fat house. What do we need God for? We got what we want. I got everything I want. Everything is everything. But you know what? We stop praying. Then we stop reading the Bible. We stop going to prayer meeting. We kick God out of the church. We kick God out of our lives just like they did at the church of Laodicea. And a lot of times, and most of the times, we don't even realize it. As T.D. Jakes likes to say, who am I speaking to today? Or who is the Holy Spirit speaking to today? You see, their church had a lukewarm faith, which was hypocritical and was full of pretend Christians. When Jesus begins to speak to this church, he doesn't have any commendations for this church. It doesn't even seem that a remnant faithful believers are even in this church. He only has words of rebuke for the church of Laodicea. He begins by letting them know that he's been watching the church. And he tells them, and he's telling us, I know your deeds. You are neither hot or cold. Jesus frequently equates deeds with a person's true spiritual state. This is what he says. By their fruit, you will recognize them. And every good tree bears good fruit. So you don't have to judge. You'll see Jesus in someone by their fruit. Amen? By their fruit. And it was obvious that the Laodiceans, they weren't keeping up with true salvation. They were lukewarm. The lukewarm are those that claim to know God, but live as though he doesn't even exist. They may go to church and practice some kind of religion, but in their inner state is one of self-righteous complacency. They claim to be Christians, but their hearts, they're unchanged. And the hypocrisy is sickening to God. It's sickening to God. So much so, he said, again, I will spit you out of my mouth. But Jesus has some good news this morning for us this morning. And that's important for us to know. See, the church of Laodicea could expect Christ to come in judgment. But after calling them to repentance, according to verse 19, he comes to them in verse 20 with a gracious invitation to God's church. He says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and will dine with him and he with me." Though this verse has been used by many preachers, and you see him in gospel tracts and booklets that depict Jesus, the picture of him knocking on the door of the sinner's hearts, the meaning of this verse is much broader than that. The door which Jesus is standing and he's knocking is not the door of a single heart. It's the door of a church that he was kicked out of and locked out. And in this case, it's the Laodicean church. You see, Jesus Christ, he was outside of his church, God's people, and he wanted to be invited in. Something that could only happen if people invited him in. Something that can only happen if people repented. How many churches today is Christ standing on the outside and knocking? Listen, this invitation is a personal invitation since salvation is individual. Today, my friends and family, he is knocking on the church door, calling members of saving faith so that he can enter his own church. Jesus Christ is still calling the church to repent and have fellowship with him before the night of judgment fell, and it was too late forever. 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 That's a long time, forever, amen? Now let me close by saying this. Many people like to quickly skim over these letters to get to the part of the book that talks about the future. What they fail to realize that is that in these letters, prepared for our hearts to receive what the rest of this book has to teach us. These are the final words of Jesus Christ to the church before he returns for them. And one day, he's going to return for us. And can you imagine? It could be today, it could be this afternoon, it could be just 15 more seconds. Are we ready? Is the church ready? Are the churches across America ready? Today we looked at the church that professed faith, but they didn't possess faith. They had not put their faith in Jesus Christ. They had a trusting religion, and they were very religious. But instead of having that one-on-one relationship with Jesus Christ, they went on their own. Now this morning, I ask you to examine your own heart. Are you cold for Jesus Christ? Are you hot? Are you lukewarm? Are you going through the motions? But there is no fellowship, there's no connection between you and the Savior. Listen, I don't want anyone going into eternity without knowing for sure where you will spend that eternity. Jesus said to those who would open the door, Jesus promised, another promise from God, Jesus promised a close fellowship pictured as enjoying a meal together. Amen? And if he offers this great reward to the one who is victorious, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne. Imagine that. Just as I was victorious and sat down with my Father on his throne. These words were Christ's commitment to the Laodicean church. And you know what, God's people? These words are Christ's commitment to the International Church of the Nazarene and all the churches across America and all the churches in the entire world. Jesus Christ is still the King of Kings. Now this morning, I invite you to stand with me. All right, let's pray. If there's anyone here or anyone online who's never received Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, I invite you to pray this prayer with me. Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus Christ. I admit that I am not right with you. I now ask you to forgive all of my sins. I accept you now as my Lord and Savior. Come into my heart and be the Lord of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you said that prayer, those that are here, those watching online, you pray that you get inside a God-based church and start with the gospel according to John. Start reading that, and better yet, let someone know, someone that you know that's on fire for the Lord, not someone that you think is wishy-washy, someone that you know. Amen? Okay. Father, Lord, we thank you for these words today, Father, Lord, and we pray, Lord, that this church doesn't become like the church of Laodicea. We pray, Lord, we're thankful, Lord, for all the possessions that you've given to us, Lord, but may we remember who gave us these things, Lord. May we not shut you out, but let you in. Every day, Father, Lord, may we realize that you still are in control of our lives. You're in control of our destination, Father, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for today for these words. We pray again that they would resonate in our hearts, Father, Lord. Maybe even read Revelations today again when we get home or sometime during the day, Lord. We give you thanks today in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And all God's people said, amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Have a blessed week. And we'll see you at prayer meeting Tuesday night, 7 o'clock. Oh, excuse me, God's people. Next week, we will have the installation. We will have the new board right here. So make sure that you let people know, especially people that are not here, that has been, hello? Hello? Did anybody hear what I said? Okay, we'll see you next week. We have the installation officers. So if you see someone that's not here, I appreciate it, or we appreciate that you let them know. Again, have a blessed week.